died that night in April 1912. Titanic was the biggest ship in the world. She'd been on her maiden voyage. For those who survived, such as Miss Hart and Ruth Blanchard and Edwina Mackenzie, life was never quite the same again. For years, Eva Hart's sleep was racked by nightmares.
I was going down and down in this lifeboat and waiting for my father to come, and never any sensation of being drowned. Just a nightmare of the whole terrible proceeding.
You wouldn't like to hear the screams of women, would you? Or men, and jumping into the water and screaming, and there was no way to save them.
People were screaming and screaming, and then all was silent. The silence was terrible.
Yet the tragedy that scarred and killed so many could have been avoided. No one knows exactly how many people died that night. Some say 1,503, others 1,522. Millionaires and their retinues, young men with their eyes set on opportunity, needy emigrants seeking a new world. The disaster shocked society because they'd said Titanic was unsinkable. The owners, the Anglo-American White Star Line, were to declare even 2 months after the great liner had sunk.
The ship was looked upon as practically unsinkable. She was looked upon as being a lifeboat in herself.
On the anniversary of the sinking, the survivors gathered in Philadelphia. Eva Hart came 3,000 miles from Chadwell Heath near London. It's a convention of the Titanic Historical Society, a group of enthusiasts for whom Titanic holds a recurring fascination.
People who wish to join the society.
And if I could have your
name, we want to make sure you have your card back here to the program.
It fascinates me. It's very dramatic, very romantic, very melodramatic. And aside from the fact that it's a great tragedy, many people died, there is still something that draws you to it. I think that this whole thing about all these people being on this one ship, and I think we tend to project ourselves onto the ship. We want to be John Jacob Astor, and we want to be Ben Guggenheim. So we're getting into those boats, literally getting into the boats, you know.
If you're lucky.
If you're lucky, right.
Edwina Mackenzie, who's 98, traveled from California to attend the convention.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
I've been obsessed with it since I was a child, and I feel very personally about it, almost religious. It's a spiritual thing for me.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be it, and then I'm going to have to ask them to join.
Five survivors are there. George Thomas traveled from Michigan.
Thank you very much. Steve, you look pretty good.
Thank you.
Sure, I never thought I would see the day when I would meet one of these people. It's like meeting a movie star or the president. It's very gratifying.
My grandmother's boyfriend went down on the Titanic. Quig Baxter, he was in first class.
Could be I walked the decks of the ships in a previous life for all I know, but it always has been of interest to me.
Since when?
I read the book when I was 9 years old.
Now, is there anything else in your life about which you could say that?
Not really.
The death of Titanic has given birth to a multitude of books and films and legends. The facts are extraordinary enough.
Same book.
The Titanic is the greatest example of if anything bad could happen, it will. Nothing went right for her. If anything could have gone wrong, it did. She didn't see the berg in time. She hit it the way it was most vulnerable to her. There weren't enough lifeboats for everybody. People didn't believe it was sinking, so they wouldn't get in the lifeboats. The nearest ship, her wireless operator, was asleep. Anything could have got wrong, it did.
More than 400 people attend the convention. The highlight, a banquet. The menu, breast of chicken White Star, with chocolate mousse Titanic to follow. 3,000 miles away from all this, one of the last surviving members of the crew, Frank Prentice. Prentice, from Bournemouth, was 18 when Titanic sank. He was a stores clerk, an assistant to the purser. To be chosen by the White Star Line to crew Titanic was an honor. Frank Prentice joined her in Southampton just before she sailed.
I could see this huge thing with four funnels. I thought she was something out of the ordinary, my gosh.
Bigger than you'd expected?
I didn't quite know what to expect.
She was the last word in luxury. All her public rooms were absolutely amazing. All the woodwork was beautifully carved, and she had everything. Everything that you could think of. She was a beautiful ship.
How many days did you have to familiarize yourself with the Titanic between the time you arrived and the time that you left Southampton?
About 3 days.
Was that enough?
Well, you wanted a week to go all around the Titanic.
Did you have any lifeboat drill?
We had no lifeboat drills. And the list of lifeboats, I believe, was put up in the galley about the day that we struck an iceberg. Nobody knew where their boats were. Lifeboats were things that they weren't necessary. You see, we were on a ship that was unsinkable.
The Titanic was born here at Howland and Wolff Shipyard in Belfast, Northern Ireland. She was one of a pair of sister ships being built simultaneously, the Titanic and the Olympic. They towered side by side above the concrete slipways as high as 15-story skyscrapers covered in a tracery of steel supports. They built special slipways a quarter of a mile long. The men who worked there 80 years ago poured into Titanic and Olympic their pride and expertise, as they recalled 60 years later.
I would say that the Titanic was the last word in craftsmanship, in shipbuilding craftsmanship.
A lovely ship, one of the greatest ships ever went to sea. Lovely, all good commendations and everything for the passengers that was going on it. It was a lovely ship and well built.
There hasn't been anything like it done since.
So beautiful and technically sound. Built with 16 watertight compartments, designed to make her, in practical terms, unsinkable. Any two of these bulkheads could be breached, and Titanic would stay afloat. And so, the legend of invincibility grew. In 1911, they built this model of Titanic as part of a publicity drive. Titanic's job was to capture a hefty share of the transatlantic market for White Star, to persuade those who were emigrating from Europe or traveling on holiday or on business to use White Star rather than, say, Cunard.
The market was enormous. First of all, there was the cream of the market, the first-class passengers. And White Star, I think, was probably, with the Olympic and Titanic, moving into the top upmarket position, because the new ship is always the one that gathers the fashionable passenger clientele. The steerage passengers, which was the emigrant trade across the North Atlantic, was colossally big. If you consider the multi-millions of people that traveled from all over Europe, many through Mediterranean or United Kingdom ports to United States and Canada, you will see that very many ships, ship owners, and the crews and officers of the ships made a living from taking these people across the Atlantic.
Titanic set out from Southampton on April 10th, 1912. She'd cost more than £1 million to build. She was licensed to carry 3,500 passengers. She was to live only 4 days. The Hart family were off to start a building business in Canada, but Eva's mother was worried.
My mother, who had been very apprehensive about the whole thing and didn't want to go, had this very firm premonition of trouble of some kind, but she really didn't know what it was. But the moment she knew that we were going in the Titanic, she said, now I know why I'm frightened. And that is because this ship was declared by the builders to be unsinkable. And her expression was that was flying in the face of God.
Flying in the face of?
In the face of God. But of course my father pooh-poohed this idea, and of course my mother agreed to go. As we got to the gangplank to go aboard, she stopped, put her hand on his arm, and she said, I will ask you just once more, do you please not go? And he said, no, I'm going.
Having left Southampton, she called at Cherbourg on the evening of April 10th and then made for Queenstown in Ireland.
A couple of tenders came out with passengers and mail and a little bit of specie. Gold and silver bars, you know.
What, to take to America?
Yes.
The Titanic left Ireland on April the 11th. She'd picked up more passengers, and she now carried more than 2,200 men, women and children. Edwina Mackenzie was 27. She was off to visit her sister.
We had a very wonderful cabin. It had two bunks and a couch in it. And I the couch was turned into a bed at night, and I had the couch for my bed. They have many card parties and get people acquainted. We had deck courts, and they did all they could to make her happy.
And were you happy?
A very happy girl, very happy.
Throughout the voyage, the sea was to be calm, the weather clear. Ruth Blanchard, who's now 83, was taking the last leg of a voyage from India.
My father was a missionary, but my little brother, who was 2 years old, was sick, and the doctors told Mother that he wouldn't live if we stayed in India. I guess it was because the Titanic just happened to be going when we wanted to go.
George Thomas, then 7, had set out only 3 weeks before by camel from his family's village in the Lebanon.
My sister used to play every day. We would play, go upstairs ways, and then come back down, and here and there. And there was a cabin next door to us, a vacant cabin. We would play there most of the time.
By the second day, Titanic was in mid-voyage. She'd already received a number of ice warnings. Eva Hart's mother had decided never to sleep at night.
Slept firmly all the daytime and sat up at night reading, doing crochet, doing needlework. And she would put on a thick woolen dress and all her clothes, and in those days there were a lot of other clothes, and she would sit there, literally waiting.
Titanic was taking the southerly of the two regular routes across the Atlantic. At this time of year, captains knew that icebergs were drifting south, having broken away from the ice cap.
Instead of going straight, we used to go around like that, you see.
Further south?
Yes.
Why?
Why? To get away from icebergs.
Early on April 14th, the third day of the voyage, Titanic received the first of a series of ice warnings.
9 a.m. SS Caronia, westbound steamer, reports bergs, growlers and field ice in 42 degrees north from 49 degrees to 51 degrees west.
We had a nursery and we had lots of toys and there was a beautiful shop. My father was always buying things for me and I had other children to play with. I had a terribly pleasant time. I loved it.
At 1:42 on April 14th, from the steamer Baltic,
Greek steamer Athena reports passing icebergs and large quantity of field ice.
Atmosphere was one gay party. They were enjoying life. They should do. They had everything. Finest food ever could be prepared for them, and all the luxury of having wonderful public rooms to go to, orchestra, dancers.
From the SS America via Cape Race at 1:45 p.m.
Past two large icebergs in 41, 27 north, 58 west.
The dining room was beautiful. You know that new silver, everything was new. And now, the queer part of it was the dining room was the only part of the ship that I remember.
From the SS Californian at 7:30 p.m.
Three large icebergs 5 miles to south of us.
Oh, they had a fine time. I'm sure they all enjoyed it.
From SS Mesaba to Titanic.
Much heavy pack ice and great number large icebergs. Also field ice.
You could smell ice. I knew it. Because you can smell it.
What do you mean?
Keenness. A keenness in the air. There's something about ice that you can smell.
From the SS Californian again, an hour before the collision.
We are stopped and surrounded by ice.
The Titanic responded, "Shut up, I'm busy." Titanic was now traveling faster than at any other time in the 3 days since she'd left Ireland.
The ship was traveling, we understand, at about 22 knots. That is nearly 25 miles an hour. And for motorists, that gives a fair impression of speed. If you were to consider the speed your car is doing as you're approaching the 30 mile an hour limit. And remember that the ship is weighing something in the region of 35,000 tons, possibly more, with water alongside, moving with it. Quite difficult to stop. Definitely an excessive speed.
Weather was perfect. Absolutely calm, and we were flat out. We were out to break a record.
Being a maiden voyage, they may well have been trying to get a convenient docking time in New York to suit the passengers and to get maximum publicity.
I was talking to a pal of mine. He was sitting on my bunk. All of a sudden, she came to a halt. There was no fuss. It was like putting your brakes on a car and you gradually came to a halt. And I went for it on the promenade deck, and I looked down. I couldn't see any damage at all above the waterline. But what I did see was ice in the well deck, the forward well deck. And I thought, hello, we've hit an iceberg.
She said she didn't know what it was, but she knew it was this terrible something that had been hanging over her for weeks. What it was, precisely, she neither knew nor cared. It was it.
I saw the purser, and I said, Mr. McElroy, if I can do any good, you let me know. If the best thing you can do is get back into bed, you catch a death of cold.
My father picked me up out of bed, wrapped a blanket around me, carried me, and put me down with my mother by a lifeboat, and he said, now don't move from here. Whatever anyone says, don't move.
The drop from the boat deck to the water was about between 70 and 80 feet. And you could hardly see the water, and people didn't want to go. They got in their minds she was unsinkable.
The officers didn't know whether it will sink or not, whether it could still float. So he said, all we can do is go in the cabin and pray.
By then, the captain had ordered out lifeboats and women and children. Lower the lifeboats and stand by. That was the order. Stand by.
He put me in the lifeboats and he put my mother in, and he said to me, now you look after your mother. And I looked up as this boat went down the side. It's a terribly long way down to that dark sea. And I remember looking up and seeing him leaning over, saying, be good, look after mummy. And that was the last I saw of him. He made no attempt to get to the boat.
It was so sad to have to take the wives away from their husbands and leave the husbands up on deck. And I knew that she was sinking then. And I knew what chances we were of just waiting for death.
At 2:20 a.m. on April 15th, Titanic sank. News of the disaster filtered through by the newfangled radio to the outside world, to America, where at first the reports comforted. Then, the enormity of the tragedy began to emerge. In England, in Titanic's home port, Southampton, whole streets went into mourning. They held two inquiries into why it had happened. The first was in America, the second in London. They said Titanic had been going too fast and that she'd ignored ice warnings, that the crew had been unfamiliar with each other and there'd been no lifeboat drill for passengers or crew, and that the watertight compartments that had made the unsinkable ship unsinkable had failed. The watertight compartments had not proved truly watertight for two reasons. First, the bulkheads extended to varying heights because they joined decks that ran through the ship at varying levels. Second, they were linked to decks that were by no means watertight. And however watertight the bulkheads, a compartment is not watertight if the top lets in water. What had happened then was that as the Titanic went down by the head, the water filled and spilled over into each subsequent watertight compartment, and so on until the end. And crucially, the inquiries agreed that when the disaster had occurred, there'd been too few lifeboats to carry the passengers and crew to safety. Rightly or wrongly, the captain of the Titanic, Captain Smith, was blamed particularly by the Americans for the fact that Titanic was traveling too fast. Rightly or wrongly, the captain of the Californian, Captain Lord, was blamed by both inquiries for failing to come quickly to the rescue of the stricken liner. And to tidy matters up, the British wrote new rules to ensure that never again would a liner put to sea with too few lifeboats to rescue all who sailed in her. But for the 1,500 men, women, and children who died in the Titanic, it was all too late. 70 years later, it all seems so obvious. If a ship carries 3,500 people, she needs seats for every one of them in a lifeboat. So why did the Titanic sail with places for only 990, plus 188 in collapsible dinghies? A situation that, in the event of disaster, must mean that 2,300 people would be left behind.
Well, firstly, because White Star Line were required by law to carry no more than that.
The lifeboats were full, and there were still over 1,500 people left behind. And the panic then must have been dreadful. We could hear it, of course, on the boat. We had people screaming and running side to side of the ship. And, you see, it was just a question of who was there. If you weren't there, by the time someone went and wakened you up and you got up on deck, there wasn't a lifeboat to get in.
It was just one mad rush to get into them, into the lifeboat.
I was thrown in. I mean, you know, he just picked me up and threw me in.
There's a man with a baby, and he said, "Stand back, stand back." He said, "I don't want to be saved, we'll save the baby." So I said, "I would." So I had the baby all night in my arms.
We got the four boats away, and they were trying to jump into them as they went down. And all the boats had gone then.
I got separated from my mother. I was lifted up by somebody and put over into another boat, which was a terrifying thing. I thought I was being thrown over the side.
The decks were lined with people, not getting off. They were lined with people looking over the railing. So when the boat, then when the water rushed into the boilers, there was a terrible explosion. And that's when I thought the boat broke in half. And that's when the people started jumping into the water and screaming. That's when they screamed. It was terrible. Screamed for the women, you know, and all.
Frank Prentice, then 18, climbed the steeply sloping deck. He perched on the stern of Titanic and looked down.
There was so much debris floating, and bodies dead and alive were all around there. So there were hundreds of them around the stern of that ship. They'd all seemed to drift down that way. They had two boards on the stern of the Titanic, which said, "Keep clear of propeller blades." And I was on the port one, hanging on. And eventually I slid off. And I had a life jacket on. And I hit the water with a terrific crash. But I didn't hit anything in the water. I was lucky. Very lucky.
When we rowed out, I don't know how far it was, but it was beautiful, just a beautiful sight. It was, all the lights were on in the Titanic, and it was listing just a little bit in the front, you know, going down. But it was a beautiful sight.
Cold, ooh, freezing. That's what killed everybody. They didn't last long. You see, a lot of them went over with half their clothes on. They didn't last long. Anyway, when I found Ricks, and he'd hurt himself. He'd hurt his legs. He dropped on something. And he didn't say very much. He was a great big fella, too. Very good swimmer. And he died. And I was eventually... I seemed to be all by myself. The cries, help, and prayers had all subsided, and everything was quiet.
And then we looked back, and the lights were gone, and the sun was over with, just like that, you know. And it's just a few minutes, and there was nobody there anymore.
And when it's over and these people are dead and they're drowning as the screams have stopped, it is a dreadful silence. It's as if the whole world stands still.
In New York, the next of kin waited anxiously for news, and the post-mortem began. The U.S. Senate inquiry said that the White Star liner had been navigated without due care. Titanic was going faster than at any other time in the voyage, and they questioned company chairman Bruce Ismay's role in the disaster. They blamed the nearby Californian, hove to in the ice, for failing to come to Titanic's rescue. And they blamed the British government's Board of Trade for obsolete and antiquated shipping laws. The British inquiry was held here in the London Scottish Hall, around the corner from Buckingham Palace. In many ways, it was a whitewash, a cover-up. Despite the death of 1,500 people on June 5th, 1912, in evidence to the British inquiry, Harold Sanderson, director of the White Star Line, declared,
"I still do not feel that it would be a wise or necessary provision to provide boats for everybody on board ship."
To understand this extraordinary statement, made even after the worst disaster in maritime history, it's necessary to understand what had been White Star's attitude to lifeboats. Lifeboats, according to Ismay and Sanderson, had been necessary only if the Titanic had broken down. Then they'd have been needed to ferry passengers from an unsinkable Titanic to the rescuing vessels that would have hurried to her aid. Besides, the Titanic had complied with the law, and that was that. Yet, to do merely what the law requires isn't always enough. We know now that the unsinkable could sink. And what if there'd been a fire and it had swept through the ship? Where would the passengers have found refuge then without enough lifeboats to flee in? That winter, the Olympic, the Titanic sister ship, slipped quietly back into Harland & Wolff shipyard here in Belfast for a refit. New as she was, on the orders of the owners, there were alterations that simply had to be made. They extended the watertight bulkheads so that they met the underside of a watertight deck.
If that had happened in the Titanic, she would have survived much longer, possibly have totally survived.
They extended the double bottom of the vessel so that it formed a double skin as far as the waterline.
It would undoubtedly have helped her to stay afloat longer.
And they increased the number of lifeboats by four times, to 68.
Everybody who was alive after the impact with the iceberg would have been saved.
After Titanic, never again were vessels permitted to travel across the Atlantic so far north when ice was breaking and drifting. After Titanic, regular lifeboat drills became compulsory. After Titanic, there was a place for everyone, passengers and crew, in the lifeboats. After Titanic, Bruce Ismay retired from the chairmanship of White Star and from public life.
She had a lot of people on board, and there must have been a lot of pockets of air, and they must have suffered more than I did, I imagine, gradually dying, because there were bulkheads all over the place. And people, some of them, didn't leave their cabins even. And they must have died in their cabins. And they must have had a lingering death. It was almost like murder, wasn't it? They had no lifeboats to look after them. Border Trade were equally to blame for allowing a ship of that description to leave port with 16 lifeboats, which could only save the crew. She was so unsinkable that it wasn't true.
On the anniversary of the death of Titanic, the Titanic Historical Society hold a memorial service. They sing again the hymn played as the ship went down. They called the disaster an act of God. Was it not much more the result of the foolishness of man?
Mrs. Manning, where were you when the ship struck the iceberg?
In the steerage class.
You were emigrating to America?
Yes, I was coming over here to my sister.
If I may ask, how old were you then?
I was 16, going on 17, be 17 in October.
When did you first realize how serious the trouble was?
Oh, I didn't until I got to this country. I thought it was part of the trip, tell you the truth. I didn't realize that there was any danger.
You didn't realize there was any danger?
No. I thought that that was pretty hard way to get here, but I didn't really think it was as bad as it was until after.
When the alarm was sounded, what happened?
Well, I was asleep at the time, and I thought then the ship had landed. So I thought we were here in this country.
Then you went up on deck?
And then I went up on deck, and then we were told to go down, that there was a piece of ice on deck, and that when they get it off, everything would be all right, to go down and go to bed.
How did you escape?
Well, we were standing on the steerage, third class, they call it, and then we couldn't get up second. And of course, then there was one man with us, and he was our guardian angel, and he said, for God's sake, let the women up. So at that, I got up.
And then you
second.
Mm-hmm. And then you got into a lifeboat?
No, then I had to go to first cabin. The lifeboats were only going from first cabin. So there was a man on the second deck, and he asked me to go on his shoulder, and I climbed over, and then I got, I think it was the last boat that was going out.
Did you take
it? One let me on because there was too many on the boat already.
But you got into the boat?
But I said to the man, I'd like to go with my sister because there was a neighbor with me, and I thought he'd feel, because I didn't want to lose the crowd. I didn't really think it was any danger, but I thought I'd miss them in the dark. You know, it was very dark.
Did you see the ship sink?
Oh, yes. I was looking at it sinking when we were in the lifeboat, because we were in the lifeboats for 9 hours.
And then which ship rescued you?
Carpathia. Carpathia picked us up then early in the morning, about 9 o'clock or something. I think it was about 9 o'clock in the morning.
I believe you were in charge of the Turkish bath on the Titanic.
I was.
And where were you when the iceberg hit the ship?
I was in bed.
And when did you first realize things were wrong?
Well, naturally the fog broke us up, and everybody got to their feet, and I went into a little passage, and I met the second steward, which was Mr. Dodd, and he said, for God's sake, get some clothes on, get up on deck. I said, what's wrong? He said, I don't know. So, of course, I had a coat on a nightdress, and we got up on deck, and everybody was most cheerful.
When did you first realize how serious things were?
I didn't think it was serious, because I didn't think it was possible a big ship like that could sink. And everybody was busy, and they was lowering the lifeboats, and the crew were marvelous. Everybody was cheerful.
And how did you escape?
In the last lifeboat, and I didn't want to go.
And then, of course, you realized that things were very serious.
Yes, I did.
And did you see the ship sink?
I did. It sank very quickly.
That must have been the most dramatic sight.
It was, because you could just see the lights going down and down.
Did you hear the music playing?
I did.
Almost till the end?
Till the end, I heard them play, you know, Nearer My God to Thee.
Nearer My God to Thee.
And I met a steward, and he said, you are, grab hold of this. And it was a baby. So I took the baby, and then when they lowered the last lifeboat, I didn't want to go. And they said, one of the other stewards, of Mr. Wheat, he was helping lower him, and Mr. Murdoch, he was the chief steward, and he was shouting out, ladies, children and women first. They was marvellous.
And you took the baby?
I took the baby, and I didn't want to go, so they said, come on. And I went down in the last lifeboat, and there was 72 in it. And you could hear the ice crash in the sides of the boats.
You saw ice all around you?
Oh yes, crashing, and the water, the ocean was as smooth as a pond.
And you were in the water until, you were in the boat until
the
daylight?
Next, yes, yeah. Bright daylight. And then we was brought on to New York, and the Lapland brought us back to Plymouth, the survivors, which had to come back. So then, of course, we was kept there a little while, and then brought on to Southampton. Of course, that was very sad, because everybody thought she knew somebody who was lost, and I had so many friends on there, and you couldn't tell them anything.
There was no impact as such. It was just like jamming your brakes on a car. And that was that. She stopped. We had a porthole open, and I looked out, and the sky was clear, the stars were shining, the sea was dead calm. And I thought, I don't know, I couldn't understand it. So I came out of my cabin and I thought, well, I go forward. And I went forward to the well deck on the starboard side, and I could see ice in the well deck. There's no sign of iceberg then, because it passed us. And the lights were shining on the water from the portholes, and no sign of damage above waterline. And of course, what had happened, we slipped over the iceberg. And although she was supposed to be unsinkable with a double bottom, the iceberg had cut her from forward on the starboard side to the engine room, right through her two bottoms. And we had orders to get the lifeboats out. And because the order, the same old order, women and children. And we swung the lifeboats out and gradually filled them up. First boats were away on the port side. The first boats away didn't have many passengers on board. They were afraid to go down. There was a 70-foot drop to the water, and they didn't think she was going to sink. And a few of the first boats on the port side got away with half filled. Don't forget, we had 16 lifeboats, and they each carried 50. And if they'd been filled, we could have saved 800, whereas we only saved 500. So you can imagine there were many seats in the first lifeboats vacant. Then I had orders to go down the storeroom with a gang of men and get all the biscuits we could find. Well, when we got back up onto the boat deck, we couldn't get near the lifeboats. Some people were scrambling to get in, being pushed back. By that time, she was listing very badly to port, and we couldn't get the starboard boats down. But before I got my lifebelt on, I met a young couple, and I can tell you her name. It was Mrs. Clark. They'd spent their honeymoon in France, and we'd picked them up at Cherbourg. And she was having trouble with her lifebelt. So I fixed that on to her, and I said, I think you'd better get into a lifeboat. And there was one in the port, on the port side. So she said, no, she said, I don't want to go there. I don't want to leave my husband. So I said, well, it's just a precautionary measure. You get in, your husband will follow later on. And I got her away, and that was that. And then I picked up my own lifebelt and put it on. Then the third class passengers were coming up. There were 700 of them, and they swarmed the decks and filled up the decks. And I thought, well, I'd done all I possibly could. I'd helped them all I could. And I thought, oh, now I'll go up and get out of all this scrumming and go on the poop deck. And she was sinking fast then. And all of a sudden, she lifted up quickly, and you could hear everything crashing through her. Everything that was movable was going through her. And then she went down and seemed to come up again. So I thought, well, now I'm going to leave. And I was hanging on to a board. We had two boards, starboard and port, which said, keep clear of propeller blades. And I was hanging on to one of these, and I was getting higher and higher in the air, and I thought, well, now I'll go. And I dropped in. I had a lifebelt on, and I hit the water with a terrific crack. And luckily, I didn't hit anything when I dropped in. There were bodies all over the place. And then I looked up at the Titanic. So the propellers were right out of water, the rudder was right out, and I could see the bottom. And then gradually she glided away, and that was that. That was the last of the Titanic. I didn't want to die, I mean, and I didn't see much chance of living, but I was gradually getting frozen up. And by the grace of God, I came across a lifeboat, and they pulled me in. And there was a fireman dead in the bottom. There was about a foot of water in this boat. There was another man who seemed to be trying to get away from it again. I don't know what was the matter with him. They were tying him down. And the rest were women and children. And I sat on a seat, and I sat next to Mrs. Clark, the girl I'd put into a lifeboat. And she said, the first thing she said, have you seen my husband? So I said, no, I haven't, but I expect he'll be all right. Anyway, I was pretty bad way then, as you can imagine, frozen solid almost. And she wrapped me round with a cloak. She had some sort of blanket or a coat on. Anyway, I think she probably saved my life, I don't know. But I saved hers, at least I think I might have done. I think I did, and she saved mine. Then first light, the Carpathia came along. Carpathia was about 7,000 tons, and they were going to the Mediterranean, absolutely loaded. And they took us all on board, took us to New York. That was that.
I believe you've even got a watch that you were wearing at the time when you went into the water.
Yes, yes. But I couldn't afford anything better in those early days. Here it is.
That says 20 past two. What time was it when you went into the water, do you think?
I think about 2 o'clock. I think it lasted. It was frozen up like I was. I think it lasted for about 20 minutes in the water.
Does talking about this incident bother you like you have been today?
Talking about it? I should probably dream of that tonight. Have another nightmare. You'd think I'm too old for that, but you'd be amazed. You lie in bed at night and the whole thing comes round again.
And write a few letters. And as I sat there writing, this was on Sunday night, the rule and regulations of White Star are lights out 11:30, especially on Sunday. So I was writing, and the call was lights out, and I turned to the steward and I handed him my letters and I said, I'll pay you for the lamps tomorrow morning. But take the letters, they're ready. And I walked down quietly down the hallway until I got to my stateroom. And just before going to my stateroom, A11, there was a bump. As I turned the handle of my room, there was another bump. And as I got into my room, there was a third bump. I thought to myself, what are these bumps? Sort of little pushes, nothing very violent. And I had made a date with the gentleman to take a cup of coffee with him that night. And I called out to him at a nearby stateroom and I said, come on, see what the bumps are. And I slipped on a coat over my white satin evening dress and went right out from my own stateroom, because my stateroom had a door leading to the promenade deck. And as I got out on the promenade deck, I saw a large gray, well, it looked to me like a building, floating by. Great big gray thing. But that building kept bumping along the rail, and as it bumped, it sliced off bits of ice, and ice fell all over the deck. And I, and a great many of my foolish fellow passengers, We just picked up the ice and started to play snowballs. We thought it was fun. We asked the officers if there was any danger and said, no, nothing at all, nothing at all. Nothing at all, just a mere nothing. We just hit an iceberg. It's nothing, nothing. I remember looking over the rail and seeing a fully lighted ship very close by. I've always said that I saw a man walking on the deck, and I did. They claim I didn't, but I'm extremely farsighted. As a matter of fact, I had defective eyesight, and I was too farsighted. Now that ship, we were told, was the California. And it was the California. With all the denials that have been made since, it was the California.
How are you so sure of that?
What's that?
How are you so sure of that?
Because it was the only other ship, and when we got on the Carpathia, we were told by Captain Rostron that the Carpathia was standing by, and the officers on the Titanic told us all, don't worry, the California will pick up everybody in case you don't come back for breakfast. Now, we were told we were only going to leave because it was rules and regulations. No danger whatsoever. We'd all be back for breakfast. And I thought it was perfectly asinine to leave a warm, comfortable ship to come back for breakfast. Mother was, why? The English have got rules and regulations, but they're just plumb crazy. I'm sticking to this ship.
And you had no idea, even long after you hit the iceberg, that you were in real danger?
No, I just thought it was ridiculous, ridiculous. So I went to bed. I was in bed, and some man, I never yet identified who he was, came to my door, knocked at the door, and said, Madam, get up. They're claiming that women and children should leave the ship. Put on your life belt. Get up. So I got out of bed. I only had one woolen dress that was out. A sheath dress, a half a yard around the ankles, so tight that from my hips to my ankles, I was practically, well, I would say I was in a potato sack. I couldn't walk. I had a hobble. In those days, they were called hobble skirts. And there I was, in this tight skirt, absolutely useless. And I put on a wool cap and a couple of foxes. I remember a white fox and a brown fox or something. And in the thinnest fur coat I had, a broadtail, which I might as well have put a tissue paper on. I couldn't have been dressed more ridiculously. And lovely velvet slippers with diamond buckles. Now, I had promised my mother never to leave my little mascot. I thought nothing of danger, and the little mascot was left on my dressing table. But I did do something that was clearly idiotic. I locked the windows of all of my staterooms. I locked every trunk. I locked the bureau drawers and the cupboards. I took all the keys, the trunk keys, and then went forward on the same deck to the drawing room, A deck, and sat down comfortably in a big easy chair. And as I sat there, Wareham, my steward, came along, and I said, Wareham, here's my trunk keys and my stateroom keys. I want my keys. I understand we're being taken off the ship and maybe you're going to be towed to Newfoundland and maybe I won't come back in time. So here's my trunk keys. When you get to Newfoundland, you go to the customs and send my trunks down to New York, will you? He said, you go on in, kiss your trunks goodbye. I said, you think there's danger? Well, he said, I've got 5 children at home. I'm a bit worried. I believe I'd kiss my trunks goodbye. Oh, I said, for goodness sakes, go back and get my pig. It's on the dressing table. And I handed him the key to my stateroom. And he came back with the pig. And my fellow passengers looked at me in utter disgust. I noticed a great many passengers forming a queue, taking their jewelry and their money from the safe. Well, I thought everything would be safer in the safe, so I left all my jewelry and I left all my money in the safe. And this little pig was never a money bag. It's been associated over the years on television shows and films that I had enough cupidity to save my money bank. I never saved a penny, not a nickel. And it took me 3.5 years of acute starvation to pay back my debts. So I had my little pig, and I felt safe. Now, why did I have the little pig? How did I come to have it?
You tell me.
Well, in 1911, I was going to the races in Deauville, again, to cover the races. And I drove to Deauville, down that dreadful, what they call the Hill of Death, before you get to Deauville. The young man who was driving the car took the wheel, didn't permit his chauffeur to drive the car. He'd never driven a car in his life before. And he went headlong into a tree. Everybody was killed but me. And were it not for the fact that in those days they had tires strapped to the back of the car, and I, by a streak of fate, was tossed into the tire. I was a little bit of a skinny thing. I wouldn't be here to tell you the story. My life was saved. I never remembered that motor accident, although they questioned me. But the night in the lifeboat, every detail, the most gruesome and the most horrible of that accident, came to me vividly. Every detail of the horror of that accident I remembered in detail in the lifeboat.
But carrying that pig, which became your mascot, how did you get from the Titanic into the lifeboat?
Well, I made up my mind I wasn't going to leave the ship. Bruce Ismay stood on B deck and kept calling out, all women and children, come to B deck. I went up twice. It was so cold. I thought myself, it was idiotic. I'm going back. And I went back twice to A deck and sat down until finally Bruce Ismay spied me and called out to me. He said, all women and children, I thought had left the ship, come up here. And I walked up to B deck, and Bruce Ismay picked me up, well, it was almost as if I was a rat terrier, and threw me down a little winding iron staircase. I fell down the iron staircase and found myself between a line of sailors on either side. And I looked down and found I'd lost one of my buckles on my shoe. I wanted that buckle. I was that much interested in the buckle and absolutely disinterested in anything pertaining to saving my life, because after all, it was an unsinkable ship, you see. What could happen to me? Moreover, I had my little pig. Nothing could happen to me. So I walked along the rail, and I found a gentleman standing at the rail. Strangely enough, the very gentleman that I had told on the tender that I was frightened to take the Titanic. And he said to me, hello, come on, you're going to get off of this ship. And I said, not me. How do you expect me to get off of anything with this thing I've got on? I'm a prisoner in my own skirt. I can't even walk, much less get up to that rail and then jump across the ocean into a lifeboat. Oh, no, not me. I'm not an acrobat. Well, he says, you'll have to. And as I stood there arguing with him, and I had my little pig, mind you, under my arm, it was white, you know, under my arm, a sailor came along. He said, yeah, now you can do as you want, but I'm going to save your baby. And he grabbed the pig, threw it into the lifeboat. So I turned around to Mr. Monk and I said, that settles it. Here I go. I don't know how I'm going to go, but I've got to go. I'm going to follow that pig. I promised my mother. Well, he may have thought I was insane. Nobody knew what the pig meant to me. So he made a cradle of his hands with another gentleman. I sat on his hands, put my arms around his neck, and he threw me head foremost through space. And I fell on the bottom of the boat and kept looking and looking for my pig. I found him with his broken, poor little legs broken, and his nose gone. Well, made me feel very badly, but I kind of turned him. I found he was still playing music, so that was all right.
Can you remember how many of you there were in the lifeboat?
Yes. I've managed to find a place on the gunwale and found that I was the next to last passenger in the last lifeboat and the only lifeboat that was full. 68 passengers, about one third of them nearly children. That was the only lifeboat that carried the children.
And how long before you were picked up?
Well, as we left the ship, the fall lines were knotted. They cut them with a knife. We struck the water. I think it was 10 minutes to 2 or 5 minutes to 2. The ship stood there fully lighted, absolutely lighted, music playing. We heard that in the lifeboat. We still saw the lighted ship alongside. In our lifeboat, we had 3 sets of oars, perfectly useless. The ocean was just as flat. Well, as a bathtub, I never saw a lake quite that flat. Inky black night, starlit, and not a ripple in the sea. And the kind of cold, well, if you want to know what kind of cold it is, just open your refrigerator door. Take a seat inside and shut the door, and you'll know what it felt like. The kind of cold that your skin seemed to congeal. Now, there I was, with nothing on practically, silk stockings, no underwear, no nothing, just about freezing to death. I sat on the gunwale, and the children were crying and whimpering. It suddenly struck me, I believe I'll play music, and then the little children maybe will be diverted and amused. And there I sat, and all night long I played the machiche, and the poor little children were so interested in the music box that most of them stopped crying, excepting one little fellow. He squealed like a pig, and strangely enough, years later, only a few years ago, there was a reunion of Titanic survivors in New York very few of us, and a great big strapping six-footer came up to me. I believe he said he was a grandfather. Said to me, "I was one of the babies in your lifeboat." And I said, "Well, I don't recognize you. You look so different today." He said, "Yes, I'm grown up now. But my mother's here." And then I remembered that that little baby had been thrown by his mother in the wastebasket, and she just walked off the ship, took a lifeboat, forgot all about the baby, and only remembered when she got on the Carpathia that she ever did have a baby. And were it not for the stewardess that heard a whimpering in the wastebasket in one of the cabins, that six-footer would not have been there to talk to me. So that's the only time I've ever been reunited with one of the babies.
And how long was it before the Carpathia picked you up?
Well, we left the ship at 2:10. It was 8:05. They told me. Well, we got alongside of the Carpathia the next morning. And at that time, Bruce Ismay pulled up alongside in a lace-frilled shirt, black trousers with stripes, braids down, no overcoat, not dressed, and not in a lifeboat, as people claim, standing up in the last collapsible raft. And he came alongside a few minutes after we, the last lifeboat, pulled alongside of the Carpathia. I boarded the Carpathia around about 8:00. They put us on little wooden planks with a rope around us. I think they call it boatswain's cradles or something of that kind. I'm not really up on nautical terms. I ought to be, but I'm not.
Have you ever traveled by boat since?
I only travel by ship. I never will travel by aeroplane. And I've traveled time and again since. And Franklin of the White Star made me return 6 months later in the same cabin with the same setup so that I would not be frightened and I would never be conscious on an ocean steamer. But after the Titanic, on the same White Star line, I was on the Majestic when she broke in half, and I was on the Olympic when she struck a tidal wave. As a matter of fact, a great many of the captains sort of avoided me, and I often wonder if the Titanic could have escaped me. I really believe sometimes I sunk the Titanic.
The first boats that got away were only half filled. And then the boats that were swinging up in the davits on the starboard side were packed, and people were trying, they were trying to get in all the way, and they were being pushed, pulled back and knocked back, and there was a bit of chaos there.
Were women and children getting on the boat first?
We got all the women and children we possibly could away first. And some of the women wouldn't leave their husbands, and we couldn't get them away. But the boats were really, truly filled up. But nobody realized then that she would sink, you know.
She was supposed to be unsinkable.
Absolutely. She had a double bottom, but unfortunately, when we hit that berg, it tore her from forehead right off the engine room, and the water simply went straight up into her. Bulkheads couldn't save her ship, because she had it. She was torn right out. It's like a knife cutting right through her.
Then you got the port lifeboats away. What happened to the starboard ones eventually?
The starboard boats were swinging in the day, which packed up, and until she gradually went down by the head and righted herself, then we were able to get those boats away, but not all of them. Unfortunately, they hurried the first two, and they were tipped. They hit the boat, and all the occupants were tipped into the water.
Then what happened to yourself? You were still on board.
I was still on board, and I couldn't do much more then. It was, see, we only had she struck at 12, and she was away at, she was down by 1:30, and I couldn't do any more then, so I began to think of myself a little bit. And then I had hid a life jacket, and I thought I'd go and find it. Well, we couldn't do any more, so the place was packed then. Oh, everybody was on deck milling around. Some were crying, some were praying. I felt rather sad myself, and so I went right aft, right up on the poop. And when I got up there, before I got up there, she was going down by the head very fast then. And I could hear everything that was movable was crashing through the ship. And in the well where the water was, you could see the water, and the stern was right out. And there were people there struggling and crying and doing all sorts of things, and some jumping overboard. And eventually, I was hanging on to the rail, and one or two up there with me had already slipped down into the water, that is, in the well of the ship, you see.
Oh, yes.
So I thought then, I felt her go down, and then she came up again. Is this like a cork, like a float, you see, sort of going down and bobbing up, and thought it was time to leave her, and so I dropped overboard then.
How far down was that?
Oh, God, I don't know. It seemed an awful long way, but I think it's over 100 feet. And I had a life jacket on, of course. That didn't, that knocked all the wind out of me. But I eventually recovered, and we were with a crowd of people then. They were all milling about in the water, saying, keep together, and we'd have more chance of being picked up by lifeboats. But anyway, I had an idea where the lifeboats were, after we sent up rockets from the bridge, and I sort of, on my unconscious mind, sort of sent me towards them, and I was eventually picked up after about 4 hours.
The evening came, and it's time to have your supper, and after supper we had community singing, and it was very, very nice, but awfully cold. So I said, I excused myself, and I said, well, I'm going to bed, it's too cold, it's about 10:30. And I was in bed in a little while, and no sooner I fell asleep, and I was sound asleep when I was awakened by the ceasing of the vibration of the boat. And I thought, well, something has happened. So I got out of bed, and finally I got into the lounge where some men were smoking, and they said, what's the matter with you, to me? Well, I said, what's the matter with me? I want to know what's the matter with the boat. And he said, oh, this isn't anything. We just grazed an iceberg.
As time went by, though, it became apparent the Titanic was in serious trouble. Soon lifeboats were being loaded.
You could not get people to go on lifeboats. You could not. They felt safer on the Titanic than in the lifeboats. But as we were running away, we could see the Titanic gradually sinking. All her lights were lit, and this row of lights would disappear, the next row of lights disappeared. And I tell you, I could see, well, just goodbye for everybody. Finally, when the boat did touch water, that scream of death is worse than any siren. And our master, the man who was manning our boat, is the master of arms, Bailey. He got us all to scream as loudly as we could. And then when she finally made her dip, he got us all to sing, pull for the shore, sailors, pull for the shore.
What was it like coming back on the Carpathia?
Very, very bad. It took us 4 days to get to New York. And I tell you, it was an awful trip.
It must have been a happy arrival, though, in New York.
Oh, how could it be happy? You know, it was a sad arrival there. You don't get happy when, you know, 1,500 were drowned. How could you be happy? No, you're sad.
Unlike other survivors, the traumatic effects have not stayed with Mrs. McKenzie. The memories, though, haven't completely vanished.
I've had vivid dreams of the Titanic, and every time I see this ship, she's way up in the sky, which I don't understand. I see the Titanic full blast, always up in the sky, but I never dreamed of her going down or anything. I've never had any nasty dreams of her.
Perhaps the most remarkable thing about Mrs. McKenzie is how clearly she recalls an event that occurred more than 60 years ago. About the voyage, she said, something she remembers as if they took place yesterday. One of those is that song she sung aboard the lifeboat.
Pull for the shore, sailor, pull for the shore. Heed not the rolling wave of bend to the oar. Safe in the lifeboat, sailors, la-la-la-la-la. Leave the poor old stranded ship and pull for the shore.
How came
You were on board the Titanic in 1912. What happened?
I was with my parents. My father was going to open a business in Winnipeg. And the intention was to go to New York and stay for a fortnight or so with a relative of his and then go on by train. People were saying to my mother and father, how fortunate you are to have got on the Titanic, because we weren't booked in her. We weren't supposed to go in her. We were supposed to sail in a ship called the Philadelphia. But owing to a coal strike, the Philadelphia didn't sail. And that's how we were transferred to the Titanic.
Were you at that time tremendously excited?
I was indeed. Not because it was a maiden voyage, that conveyed nothing to a child. But excited because my father was so delighted about it and my mother was horrified.
Horrified? Now, why was that?
My mother said to my father, isn't that the ship that they say is unsinkable? And he said, no, this is the ship that is unsinkable. And so clearly I remember the look on her face when she said, but that is flying in the face of God. And I am so frightened. My mother never went to bed in that ship at all.
That's extraordinary. Of course, what happens is now when I see pictures of the Titanic, it fills me with a kind of horror. But I'm wondering whether I'm projecting on it what I know about the vessel, these four sinister funnels and so on like that. Is that a feeling you had at the time before the terrible disaster, or just a young girl's excitement?
No. I was excited because I was going in a wonderful big ship with my mother and father. I had no feeling of fear or of apprehension or of anything. But my mother was terrified, so terrified that she said, I will not go to bed in this ship. And she went to bed all day and sat up all night. So I can thank her for being here today.
So you went to Southampton and you went on board the ship. What do you remember of the Titanic? What was she like to be actually on board her, inside her?
Well, very beautiful. It was the first time I'd ever been in a ship. And so at that time, I don't suppose I was as impressed as I would be now, because with hindsight, and haven't travelled in quite a number of ships since, I realised how very beautiful it was. I was a second-class passenger, which again was, from what I remember, quite as beautiful as some of the smaller first-class ships I've travelled in. But in the first class, it must have been absolutely out of this world. I'm told, on very good authority, there were Turkish baths, there were gymnasiums, there was a fantastic staircase, which I imagine the ladies would sweep down in their Edwardian dresses. And it must have been luxurious beyond words.
Now, what was the boat deck like? That was the great area on the top, wasn't it, where people would walk along. Can you describe what it was like to walk along as far as you could? Because, of course, you couldn't walk, I believe, all the way along as you were second class.
Well, it was a lovely big deck with these lifeboats at the side and these enormous funnels and lots of deck chairs and plenty of people walking about, and the weather was so cold. I was quite glad when my father, who had charge of me all day because, I say, my mother was asleep, I was quite glad when we went inside to the nurseries and places to play. But it was a very lovely deck, of course, very large.
Let's get on then to the voyage. She moved away from Southampton, she went to Cherbourg, then to Ireland, and then set out across the Atlantic itself. What was life like on board?
Well, there were three classes. I can't say anything about the first or the third. But for the second class, I don't think that the fact of being at sea conveys very much to a child. There was so much to do. I was so fond of my father. And I'm quite sure I got away with a lot of things with him that I never would have done for my mother. He spoiled me very much. And the days went by and I was very happy.
Did you by any chance, even though you were in second class, meet the captain?
Oh, yes, I did. Captain Smith, he was on deck when my father and I were on deck. I imagine he went all over the ship. And he was very nice. He had a beard like my own grandfather, and he admired a doll I had. I had this beautifully dressed doll, and I had a big teddy bear too, which a lot of the children used to play with. And he admired my doll. I remember talking to him and my father telling me that he was the captain.
In those days, they wouldn't have had a cinema. You said they had a nursery?
Yes, a room where we played with dolls and rocking horses and things, yes. I don't know whether they called it a nursery, but it reminded me of my own.
What about the dining room? Because the second-class dining room, looking at the plans now, we can see was huge. It stretched the whole width of the ship.
It seemed to me to be very large, and looking at the plan, of course, it obviously was very large. I remember my father commenting on the food and saying how good it was, and there seems to be a copy of a second-class menu for luncheon, I think, on the Sunday, as she sang, on the Sunday night. I've seen that in so many books, but I can't say I remember eating it, obviously.
Well, came the fatal day itself, which you said indeed was a Sunday. Have you any memories of that Sunday before she actually struck the iceberg, or was it just a pleasant Sunday? Or did you have services on board ship or anything like that?
Most certainly I have very vivid memories of that Sunday, because my mother, who normally got me ready for breakfast and came and had breakfast and then went to bed for the rest of the day, my mother decided after breakfast that she wouldn't go to bed. She'd wait up for the church service, which was held in the second-class dining saloon. And she did, and we went to this church service. I thought that immediately after she would go to bed, but she decided to have lunch with us. So that was the last meal that the three of us ever had together, because, of course, by the time one had dinner at night, I was in bed. But we had lunch together, and I don't know. I can't say whether I felt any particular anything, except that it was the first time that she'd stayed up for lunch. And that I remember very clearly. And I got very friendly with a little dog, which I believe belonged to a very wealthy American, but it was being taken to America. The owner wasn't on board. And I got very friendly with this little dog and used to play with it. I used to have to go aft, I suppose, onto the third-class deck alone. And my father got friendly with one of the sailors who used to take me. And I remember playing with that little dog. And, of course, after the sinking, I was worried about that little dog. It wasn't saved, of course. But I remember that Sunday very well.
Well, came the actual moment when she struck the iceberg, the Titanic struck the iceberg, which happened at 20 to 12 on Sunday night. Now, you were presumably in bed. Were you asleep? Were you awake?
Oh, no, I was sound asleep. And my mother, of course, wasn't, and she said to my father, "You must go up on deck and see what's happened." And she'd had him up on deck the night before because she heard a noise, so he wasn't very happy about going up. But she absolutely pulled him out of bed. She wakened me and she said, "I'm going to dress you." But before she could do so, my father came back from going up onto the deck, and he said, "You'd better put this thick coat of mine on." That was all he said. And, you know, years afterwards, I would say to my mother, when he came back, you didn't say to him, "What was it?" Surely the normal thing to do would have been, if you sent someone to look for something, when they came back, to say, "What is it?" But she said, "I didn't have to ask him. I didn't know what it was. I only knew that it was this awful fear that had been with me." Anyway, she put this thick coat on, and he picked me up and wrapped a blanket round me. And we went up onto the boat deck.
So up into the boat deck, and already quite a lot was happening. Within about 20 to 25 minutes, they were uncovering the boats. What can you remember of what you saw and heard up there at that time?
I always query that they were doing that so quickly. It seemed a very long time to me, because my father said to my mother, "Stay here by this lifeboat, and I will go and find someone and see if we can find out what's happened." Because we were on the port side of the ship, and you know, don't you, that the impact was on the starboard side. And the superstructure of that ship was a huge funnel. It was very high. Standing on the deck, you couldn't see what had happened the other side unless you went either aft or forward and went round. And he came back quite quickly and said, "The ship has struck an iceberg." My mother didn't say, "I told you so," or anything like that. She just remained quite quietly. And then he went away again and came back and said, "I've been speaking to one of the officers and they are going to lower the boats, but you'll all be back on board for breakfast." And all that took place, which always makes me feel that 25 minutes isn't quite right, but I could be wrong. Anyway, they did, of course, lower the boats, and my father had no difficulty in putting my mother and I in, because, as I say, we were there. But he made no attempt at all to get in himself.
Was there a tremendous bustle? I mean, one's read so much now, it's part of the folk memory about the band playing, about the appalling sound of the steam being let off from the funnels. I mean, can you remember that? What do you remember about going on round you?
I remember the steam. It terrified me for years. I remember the steam hissing. I remember some music playing, and I refute the fact that it was an orchestra. I'm quite sure in Bill McQuist's film, A Night's Remember, when he featured three musicians, that was much more likely to be right. And Commander Boxall said so too. So it's not a band, and I think you'd have to be very close to hear it, and we were. I remember the fact that there didn't seem to be such a lot of people about when we got into the lifeboat, But then it seemed throngs of people were coming onto the deck. And when we were down in the water, we could hear the people rushing about on the deck. And I'm sure that's when the panic must have started, when people got up onto the deck and found there wasn't a lifeboat there.
As a seven-year-old child, were you frightened at that moment, or were you just curious?
I was terrified.
And you really knew that something appalling was happening, no doubt at that age at all?
I would have been an idiot not to. Of course I knew. I wasn't certain what a shipwreck meant in effect or how long it would be, but I was too terrified to do anything but shriek for my father, who I knew we'd left behind, and to be terrified of the whole thing.
It was an extraordinary business, wasn't it? Because here we have a shipwreck taking place on an absolutely flat, calm night. Can you describe the scene? Here you are now in the lifeboat, and you're looking back. What did the Titanic actually look like before she actually sank?
Well, before she sank, she was a very beautiful ship, stationary on the ocean with all her lights on. I don't know what the temperature was, except that it was dreadfully cold, but the sea was the calmest I think I've ever seen. It was the most starlit night I've ever seen. The sea was so calm, it was uncannily calm. And then gradually she sort of seemed to me to sort of settle down in the water. You are so low on the ocean in a lifeboat that it's not very easy to gauge heights and distances. Four parts of the ship dived down nose first, but I don't know how long it was, but it seemed a terribly long time. But even when that part went under the water, the lights were still on, you know. And I looked back and I just saw the whole of that tragedy. I saw that ship break in half, and all through these years when people have said it didn't, I still maintain that I was wide awake and never closed my eyes again. And my mother also, a thoroughly sensible woman, used to say, of course it broke in half, and the front part went down and left the stern sticking up in the air in a horrifying fashion, and that gradually went down, turning over. I know that's a fact. But it was enormous. And even when we were so far away that she sank, and you get as far away as you can because of the suction, it was a tremendous ship. But I am absolutely convinced, of course, that she broke in half. There's no doubt about that. And the stern stuck up in the air for a long time, it seemed to me.
Well, indeed, in the latest evidence which we've seen from the expedition, underwater expedition, we know that the stern is a considerable distance away from the bow. So, in other words, it could not have broken up just underwater. And the second thing is, according to Walter Lord's latest book called The Night Lives On, he quotes, I think, something like 16 witnesses who bear that out as well.
That's right. My mother was perfectly firm about it. And as I say, she was a very calm, sensible sort of woman. And she was absolutely convinced about it, and so was I. Oh, I saw it. And over these years, people have talked to me and said, oh, no, you're quite wrong, you were too young to remember. I was not too young to remember. I was not too young to see a dreadful thing like that and never forget it, and I know it happened.
Many reports say that as she broke up or she went underwater, there was also a tremendous sound, a roaring sound.
That's right, there was. Tremendous roaring sound. And there'd been all this escaping steam, I suppose, as they drew the boilers, I don't know, but the noise of steam was absolutely terrible. And she did have a big roaring sound. And after that came the worst sound of the whole disaster, which was the sound of people drowning. And that's something that no one can hear and ever forget. I used to say to my mother sometimes how dreadful that was, and she used to say to me, yes, but do you remember the dreadful silence that followed it? And it was. It seemed as if the whole world was standing still for minutes after the last sounds went. Terrible.
Yes, I should think it was. There you were, with the vessel gone. Can you remember what happened, apart from these terrible cries, what else was happening round you? Were you surrounded by other boats? Was it, what?
They keep all the lifeboats as close together as they can. And it was discovered that the boat that I was in was overcrowded. And the officer in charge of our boat, Fifth Officer Lowe, decided that he would get rid of his load by putting two in that one and three in that one and four in that one, calling them all together, and go off with an empty boat when he picked up a few people who died quite quickly. So that boat could have been properly filled in the beginning if we'd had a boat drill. Now, during the course of two going into this boat and three going into that, I got separated from my mother. I didn't find her until the next day on board the Carpathia.
In fact, we now know that the Titanic ran not merely into an iceberg, but in fact there was a whole ice field.
Yes, the next morning, as you looked round, they were like white sails. In the distance, you could see them like white yachts. I don't mean white. Yes, white sails on yachts. With the sun on them, were very beautiful. But they were all round us, yes.
So you have this extraordinary contrast, the horror, and a few hours later, something which really was very, very beautiful.
Yes, it was. The sea began to get a bit choppy as it got light. But the icebergs, whatever direction you looked in, they were there. They reminded me as a child of the sails of a yacht.
There have been reports, again, there's so many confusing details, that there was a light somewhere on the horizon. In other words, a ship close by which might have come and rescued, but of course didn't until it was too late.
That's absolutely true, because I can remember constantly saying to my mother in that first lifeboat, why doesn't that other ship come? You could see it clearly.
You were rescued, a few hours later?
You see, I don't know what time I left the Titanic. People say to me, when did you get in the boat? I can't tell you. I got in the boat when it was lowered. I know that I was transferred into another lifeboat from the original one, as I've told you. And that one that I was in then was the last one to be taken up in the Carpathia, and I understand that was about 8 o'clock in the morning.
You were rescued by the Carpathia. What happened then?
Well, they were very kind and good to us. I was shrieking my head off for my mother and eventually found her, because she had no idea where I was. She had been put into a boat, I suppose, probably, say, off the starboard side of the lifeboat, and a sailor grabbed me on the port side of the lifeboat and pushed me in another one. I don't know. I only know that when I got into the second lifeboat, she wasn't there. And as she said, when she was put in the other lifeboat, I wasn't there. But I found her, I don't know how long after. We were given clothes, because I'd only got my night clothes and a blanket round me. My mother, of course, was fully dressed, because she sat up all night fully dressed every night of the voyage. But they were very kind and good to us, but of course they hadn't got cabins for us, because I suppose the little ship was pretty full anyway, and she was quite small. But I can remember I was put on a settee in a dining room and looked after as well as they could.
What happened to you then? You eventually arrived where? New York?
New York, yes.
You realise eventually, obviously, that your father had gone. I mean, do we now have years of misery ahead of you after that? Or?
No. The first thing my mother said when we got to New York was, how soon can I go home again? There was no point in her going on to Canada. My father was a master builder, going into partnership there with a friend. Well, she couldn't manage that business. So we came straight back to England and back to my mother's parents, who were still alive. And although for the rest of my life I didn't have as much money as I would have had when my father was alive, because we were pretty comfortably off. But he had gone to Canada, or was going to Canada, because his business wasn't very good. But anyway, we managed, and my mother and I were very happy. We were terribly upset about my father, but life went on from there.
And from there, of course, well, I'm not going to ask you to summarise the whole of 75 years, but we had the First World War, the Russian Revolution, the Second World War, Hitler's come and gone, we've had China going communist, I mean, we've had all that, I mean...
And I lived in one of the heaviest bombed parts of London. The bombs fell here right through the war to a terrible extent. I felt, well, if there's one with my name on, I should get it.
So you had that to put up with as well.
Oh, yes.
Quite a life. Of course, what has happened recently is that the Titanic has suddenly surfaced again. And it surfaced again because, of course, of the Woods Hole expedition. Dr. Robert Ballard found her in 1985. And I wonder what your reaction was initially, when presumably, like all of us, you saw on television, first of all, a picture of a boiler undersea, and then these tremendous pictures which came up.
It's very difficult to say. They didn't convey to me anything about the Titanic at all. I was glued to the pictures because I thought they were such a wonderful scientific achievement. They were a wonderful thing, but it never at any time gave me the horrors like pictures of the Titanic do. I got enormous admiration for Dr. Ballard because I did so hope that no one would ever attempt to raise parts of the Titanic. I won't say raise the Titanic because it's in bits. But I was so grateful about his attitude, and he has written to me, and I hope to meet him next month. And I felt it was wonderful, but it didn't upset me from the point of view it being the Titanic.
This is what I noticed different. I said, we've got one interview of you a few years ago in the BBC, a very short one, and at that time, you couldn't, for example, describe the sinking. It so upset you, you said, it sank, and that was it.
Yes.
Whereas now, you have given me a wonderful description, and you seem now at least to have been able to come to terms all these years later, at least be able to describe this event without being appalled. Well, you're obviously intellectually appalled, but immersively, you haven't been emotionally overcome by it now.
Well, I've done so many television programmes in the last 10 years in, oh, everywhere, Germany, France, Canada, America, Australia, Singapore. I've done so many for so long now. And as we've got so scarce on the ground, there's nobody around, I think that's helped me.
Yes. It's almost, dare I say, it might have been almost a form of inadvertent therapy.
Yes,
I mean,
possibly. That's why I first went to sea. My mother died when I was 23, and from the time of the Titanic disaster until she died, I was so frightened I wouldn't go across the Isle of Wight. But when she died and I was entirely alone in the world, I went to sea as, as you say, a therapy. And although I wouldn't like to say I'm not frightened of the sea, I lost a lot of the horror. And I've been in many ships since, but I've never been in anything that was touching the Titanic for beauty. And she was so beautiful to look at, too. She was lovely.
Did you actually have nightmares about this sort of, about the Titanic sinking?
I had nightmares from the time it sank until I was 23. Terrible nightmares. And I used to wake in a terrible state and go to my mother's bedroom, and I saw her there, and I immediately calmed down. I didn't even waken up. If she was there, that was all right. When she died, I realised that these nightmares would get even worse. I hadn't got her to go to. And so I evolved what today is called a therapy, decided the only thing I could possibly do would be go to sea. And I didn't come out of my cabin for 4 days and nights. I was too frightened. But by that time, the stewardess realised I wasn't seasick. Absolutely made me get up on deck. And from that time onwards, I have travelled by sea until the war came, but of course, since the war, I fly. But it didn't cure me, but I've never had nightmares since. It cured the nightmares.
When you go to see Dr. Ballard, what's going to happen? Do you know?
Well, the Titanic Historical Society are having a convention in Delaware to not celebrate, I suppose, to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the disaster. And he is coming to that convention, and I am going.
And I gather, I mean, we've already seen in the National Geographic magazine that he's been putting together some of his photographs.
That's right.
And presumably he's going to try and put together what, an enormous mosaic and perhaps a book?
Possibly, yes. He told me in his letter that he hoped to see me at the convention and that he was working hard on some work for it. Mm. I don't quite know what. Mm.
Here you are now, a pensioner, shall we say, in terms of age. And I mean, are you in some ways now, having got through this terrible experience, enjoying it, because now you're becoming, as it were, in your 70s and your 80s, a celebrity? You are an historic figure, aren't you? I'm
a page out of a history book, and there are days when the pages feel a bit tattered. The schools are doing all sorts of things about the Titanic projects, and I've been all over the place as recently as 2 days ago, talking at the schools, and I am astounded at the knowledge the children have of this disaster. And as you say, I've become almost a celebrity. Sometimes I quite enjoy it because I get asked to various nice dinners and things. Sometimes I get very bored. There was a period last year when I wasn't very well, and I was going out talking about it 4 nights a week for 5 weeks. And at the end of that time, if anybody mentioned Titanic to me, I just felt like saying, go away.
But nonetheless, what must be fascinating is the reaction of children, because I suspect, I've seen
That's
this happen,
wonderful.
That young people, when one gets older, sometimes young people tend to regard elderly people as whatever has-beens or what have you. Mm-hmm. But with something like this, of course, they do the very opposite, don't they?
They do. That's perfectly true. It's, the children are very, very knowledgeable about it, and very interested in it. And I always advise the schools when I go there, I say to them, try and get a copy of A Night to Remember and let the children see that, because it is the only film that's ever been made about the Titanic which is absolutely authentic. And Commander Boxall was alive when that was made, as you know, and helped us with it. But I don't think there's any doubt the children should see that film and not these other stupid things that people have made. Very often I get a letter to say, got a copy of the film and showed it to the children.
Did you ever think one day that the Titanic would actually be discovered? I mean...
I didn't think so, no.
There are many people who are talking about raising the Titanic, something which is obviously going to be much more difficult now. She's broken into pieces, the insides have been torn out, she is a shell. What's your feeling about the basic principle of raising her?
I don't think she should be raised. I'm not the sort of person that goes and haunts people's graves. I look upon a grave as just a piece of earth in which there is a rotting body. That doesn't worry me very much, but in this case, 1,513 people died unnecessarily. They shouldn't have died. If there'd been enough lifeboats, they wouldn't have died. But all this vast tragedy and everything that happened about it makes me look upon it as a different sort of grave. And I entirely endorse what Dr. Ballard said. His actual words were, "It is quiet and peaceful, and a fitting place for the remains of this greatest of sea tragedies to rest. May it forever remain that way. And may God bless these found souls." And that's exactly how I feel about it.